Issue 160. We started with Elias explaining to Sonic why his father had approved the metal Sonic Troopers that were meant to defeat Eggman in Sonic's absence. Sonic cheerfully says that he'll buy it. I'm hoping that he's just joking with that. And he says that his father should have known that a Doomsday weapon wouldn't stop him. The Doomsday weapon is in the Zorda Quantum Dial. Really, Sonic? From everyone else's perspectives, he got caught in an explosion. It should have been obvious to him why people would assume he was dead. And this Elias explaining stuff could have been assumed to have happened off-screen. I mean, why would Elias even think he needed to explain it to Sonic? Why would Sonic think he requires an explanation for why they want to make some sort of substitute for him to fight Eggman? You'd think it would be obvious, but instead, we get the first panel wasted. At least it leads into the next one, which has some charming dialogue as Sonic teases, "Can you promise me that's the last brilliant idea you royals come up with?" And Elias surprises me by saying, "Sally and I have just one more left." That made me smile. But that was a brilliant idea, though. The only reason it went wrong was because the robots didn't know what to do when they saw Sonic and because they were reprogrammed to go hurt Hope for some weird reason. Other than that, it should have been obvious it was a great idea. For some reason, Sonic wonders if Elias is planning to nix the Great Oak Slide. And Elias tells him their idea is the exact opposite. Then we see Sonic being thrown another birthday party, the second one we saw since he returned to Moetropolis with Nate. I'm assuming that was exactly 1 year ago. And that birthday party is in the old base, which his friends fixed up. It was broken? I didn't know that. Fiona hugs him saying, "Happy birthday, handsome," while he doesn't really make an effort to hug back, and just smiles about the base being fixed up. And Elias explains that the reason this old base from simpler times was fixed up was a place for freedom fighters to plan, a new focal point reductor Robotnik that is away from our families. The first one they can plan in Sally's castle just fine, but the second one, that's a very good point. I'd be a lot happier about this base thing if it was made clear to me at any point that the base had been destroyed earlier, but it hadn't been. I remember seeing the king in it when Sally was ranting at him after Moetropolis was taken over by Eggman, and then it just dropped off the face of the earth. While Sonic has his arm around her casually, and says with an unsettlingly sly smirk for some weird reason, "How old are you now?" Gordon tries to take his trip into space into account, and Sonic then annoys me by saying, "Let's call me a teen from now till forever." Okay, I get that he's youthful by his very nature and therefore would always want to be a teenager, but that's not going to be the case. We know that he was in space for only 6 weeks, and he simply went through a wormhole putting him ahead in time, and so I don't see what the big deal is. And why they couldn't just say Sonic's age already. It would be a year older than last time. 17, right? This panel just confuses me. Suddenly there's an explosion, and Bean and Bark show up for what I can't believe is the first time after all these issues, with Bean singing because he's insane that Eggman hired him to blast Sonic with bombs. I guess criminals will take money from literally anyone no matter how much they hate him. And plus Bean's insane and so he wouldn't care. But couldn't these guys just threaten to get whatever they want? Why would they need money then? It's kind of arbitrary that they do this, villains or not. Now, if Eggman offered to give them superpowers of even some minor kind, like with cybernetics, then it makes sense that they'd take the job. I'd question how Eggman knew where the base was, but it's been said he knows everything they do from now on from spying on Nicole, so whatever. I guess we're supposed to just assume Eggman's omniscient like her now. Sonic starts the fight saying that Fang's in jail. So good, Sally didn't release Fang just because he agreed to tell her why he tried to kill Mina. So she lies straight to his face to get information out of him. I wish we saw that manipulating side of her more often, it shows us how clever she is. Maybe she was only talking about how she would keep him separated from his old weasel friends, but still be in jail. Bark gets a treat to use the weapon, and Sonic tells him not to damage the Great Oak Slide. If it's damaged, how are they going to get out of here? He gets knocked away, and Tails is nice enough to catch him while flying, even with his issue with him recently, and Sonic, after calling him Little Bro, which I love and he really should say that way more often, says that he thinks he knows why Bean and Bark took the job. Why? He then says that Scourge did a lot of stuff under his name. He references that he managed to get the girls to understand. No, he didn't. There were several references earlier implying that he didn't tell them. So if he corrected them, why did he wait so long and do it off-screen at that? I guess that's a positive retcon. After he tells Bean that he might think they're after him from what Scourge did, Bean of course says he didn't know about Scourge at all and says the line, "Frankly, Cobell, I don't give a damn." Oh, sorry, I don't give a darn. That's a very awkward and stilted line because of the darn at the end. A criminal would not say darn. And that's one of those phrases, like payback's a bitch, that just sounds lame all cleaned up. They shouldn't have even used that phrase at all. But yeah, it's weird he said that also because he was just talking as if he was interested in Sonic having an evil twin, just to say he doesn't care at all. Rouge is shown in the Master Emerald's chamber, and then is suddenly all surprised at seeing Scourge wearing his more trademark leather jacket with a badass fire design on it and cool red and black shoes. I'm really confused that she's surprised at seeing him. Didn't she go off with him to Down Under? Suddenly it's like that plot thread was completely dropped because now she's acting surprised that he's even there. Did he come with her to Angel Island just to leave her briefly to go get these cool new clothes that fits like Danny more? Just to come back and now Rouge recognizes him as Scourge? This is so confusing. He looks adorably awkward and nervous, saying, "Oh, snap. Locke didn't catch you?" So he's planning that Rouge would be caught and he'd take the emerald for himself. How did she avoid getting caught? Did Locke get distracted by a butterfly? He's always guarding the emerald. I was wondering how she got in here from the minute she was shown. Also, oh snap. Again, I don't buy that a criminal would say something so tame. Especially not Scourge. Is this just he's like Sonic shining through again? Oh, okay, they're still partners. As Rouge says that they had a deal that naturally Scourge would be the distraction this time. A deal, meaning she naturally figured out he was Scourge earlier since he might suck at keeping the secret and she's clever. Considering she said evil Sonic when she was surprised at seeing him instead of, "Hey, what are you doing here?" It makes sense that I get confused. Scourge explains that he didn't see Locke, so he figured he'd gotten to Rouge already. Locke clears his throat and tells them his patience has worn thin. Why was he being patient to begin with? I guess this is the same Locke who stupidly tried to stand there and reason with robots trying to steal the emerald, but the last time he saw Scourge here, he immediately made him fly out of the chamber. Why didn't he do that instead of saying this? Scourge complains, "Give me a break, man, it's my birthday!" Meanwhile, Fiona says, looking serious, "I hope this still works," with some keys on the keychain, and distracts Bean, who is attacking Sonic's head, by using some shiny keys. So there's her being useful, for the second ever time since dozens of issues. So good on you, Fiona, you were helpful. I'm sure the Freedom Fighters will be incredibly grateful and appreciative of you for using your knowledge of Bean against them. After Sonic says, "Nice move, Fiona," and then asks how she knew to do that, she has my sympathy as she gets all awkward and says, "Hold that spot, Sonic." Obviously not wanting to admit that she used to know Bean. I guess she was too nervous at the moment to simply say that Bean inconvenienced her in the past and she learned his weakness by accident from being enemies with him. Never say that Fiona is a master liar. This all happens while Antoine has Bark backed up against the wall with his sword, taking advantage of Bark not knowing he's bluffing with it, I guess. She says to Bark angrily with all of the other heroes behind her, "You're outnumbered, Bark. You can't take all of us at once." That's a badass line, I guess. Then after Bark sits down with his hands in the air, Fiona says with a triumphant smirk, "I'm glad you're still reasonable." Why would you say that out loud? She doesn't want her friends to know she knows him. Has she given up on them not finding out already? But still, she convinces Bark to give up with reason. Although that time her usefulness was pretty pointless because the heroes would have all won anyways, it just would have taken longer. Maybe all she did was save them a few bruises and wasted time in the process. Meanwhile, after Bean implies that he's hearing voices from the keys, he asks someone approaching him if he wants to help pummel Sonic. Wait, why the hell is he all the way outside the base? I have a hard time believing Fiona was able to throw the keys that far, especially since the base is underground. Does she have a throw keys outside the base superpower? Did Bean run all the way out of the base for no reason just because he had the keys? He wanted to escape the fight to avoid getting hurt while he was talking to it, I guess, but I wouldn't expect him to have the common sense to do that. Meanwhile, I really feel horrible for Fiona here, as Sally has was possibly the third worst bitch moment of her entire career, angrily pointing at her saying judgmentally, "You have a lot of explaining to do." Fiona, with her arms crossed and looking away annoyed, says a great line here that makes my heart ache in sympathy even more. "Sorry for helping out. Go team." Oh my god, that's almost tearjerker worthy. Especially since I know it's coming later. Sally should be thanking her, not being a judgmental bitch. Besides, isn't she jumping to the conclusion that Fiona used to work with Bean and Bark way too easily? Wouldn't it be just as logical for her to assume Oh, Fiona must have had to deal with these criminals as enemies before, since criminals tend to antagonize people a lot. Therefore, she'd know how to defeat them. But no. This is consistent with Sally's paranoia, though. Remember how she was paranoid of Jeffrey being evil when she first met him? Maybe it makes sense that she jumped to that conclusion. The only thing comforting about the situation is that Rotor had to hold Tails back from angrily approaching Sally, proving that Tails would have stood up for her, and Alias was being held back by Sonic. But that just irritates me too, because there's no reason they couldn't have opened their mouths and said something, anything, in her defense, just because they were being held back. What if things had gone differently because everyone all stood up for her? Instead, silence. And even then, Fiona isn't benefiting from that because it's not like she's looking in their direction, so she probably doesn't even know that Tails and Alias want to go defend her at all. That's tragic. Then Sally says, "That's not the point, how do you know these two?" Instead of even so much as saying a thank you for helping out, just completely dismissing her contribution and belittling her. Fiona looks the most sympathetic she ever will be, rubbing her arms, saying, "Look, I've had a checkered past, okay?" She's clearly awkward about admitting it. She might be a bit ashamed, but Sally doesn't care. She still looks at her like a judgmental bitch anyways. Fiona says she hasn't always been afraid of Fighter, as in a nicer way of saying, "I had a life before I met you, you know," and shrugs, trying to ease the tension with casualness, but it's obvious that she's still nervous from her expression. Thank God, at the very least, Sonic is sweet enough to say, "But you're a welcome part of the team, Fee," with his hands on her shoulders to comfort her, and a nervous smile showing that he feels sorry for her. And then he changes the subject, asking if they should go look for Bean. At least Sonic is trying to help her. Sonic is being very welcoming right now. Keep that in mind for later. Shadow then shows up, holding a stunned Bean in an amusing way, and snarks in a deadpan way, "Happy birthday, Blue Hedgehog, I clean your yard for you." I smiled a lot at that line. It was funny, but I didn't laugh because that line had already been spoiled for me a long time ago. Meanwhile, Rouge flies towards Locke, snarking musingly, "We have to stop meeting like this, Locke." That made me smile a lot more, actually. And Scourge revs up the spin dash, proving that he knows how to use it despite not having a lifetime of fighting robots requiring it. Locke uses his magic to make him miss or something and land on his head, which immediately proceeds to give him brain damage and make him unable to— No, of course not. Instead, he's fine. Not even a headache. Instead, he seems to instantly warp to standing on top of the Master Emerald, without us seeing a blue blur go past Rouge to get up there. She asks him to give her a hand, and when he says, "Sorry, Rouge, but the birthday boy gets dibs on the goods," Rouge says, "You jerk! You're surprised? You should be thankful he's nice enough to say sorry at all." It's a pleasant twist for an evil twin. And ask why he can't just attack Locke at the speed of sound and help Rouge out in like a second. But considering Locke made him miss his spin dash, even though he must have been moving him way too quickly for him to magic him in time, I don't blame Scourge for thinking he wouldn't be able to help without a power boost, and for not telling her that, because admitting he's too weak would be way too embarrassing. I gotta say, I'm loving the story, even if it is really easy to nitpick to death. Scourge immediately turns green from absorbing power with Master Emerald, although he doesn't have shades, which he'd look way better with. Which is weird since the same shop that sold him the rest of his clothes you'd think would have shades too. Rouge gloats about Scourge attracting Locke's attention, calling him a traitor, and Locke attacks Scourge's chest with his glove glowing yellow, giving him a scar. I could only assume that yellow is from fire. But Scourge goes back to standing just fine after that, because I guess the power of Master Emerald made his skin way harder to burn, but still lets it scar, so it's not too helpful. While Fiona is naturally standing against the wall with her arms crossed, looking out in the window all depressed, still clearly dwelling on the way she was treated by Sally, Shadow tells Sonic that he came to thank him for saving Hope. Aw, that's a pretty sweet background moment that I wasn't expecting at all, as Fiona gets given a drink by Tails since he wanted to make her feel better from her predicament, and she proceeds to ruffle his hair like a big sister as a reward that he absolutely relishes in. Although it's hampered by the fact that, thanks to the above view camera angle, I can't see her smiling, and Tails' smile looks really creepy because he's staring off into the distance and his pupils are shrunk. He looks like a serial killer. This is happening while Sonic is nice enough to shake Shadow's hand, despite the fact that he's telling him he's still working for Eggman because of their shared relation to Maria. Though he doesn't even mention that part. Sonic is being nice enough to shake hands with a guy who's working with Eggman for apparently no reason to him, looking on the bright side because it'd be boring otherwise, and saying, Feel free to get a clue and quit Eggman anytime, though, without actually telling him why he should quit. He's being so good-natured about this. Remember that. Then Rotor finds out that Bean's talking to Eggman on a monitor in the Freedom Fighter's Brain Trust room. So they got him unconscious, and they were too stupid to tie him up or put him in handcuffs. He simply tells Eggman he lost. And Fiona made me smile at how she scolded him like a nagging mother. Bean, go sit with Bark. And Bean walks away with his head down saying, "Aww." Is Bean a kid? Or just an adult who's insane and so he's mentally stunted B1? Either way, I like seeing that disciplining mother side of her. It's a shame it'll be so rare, as well as nearly every other aspect of her. Eggman says he's launching Sonic's birthday present now as he ends the transmission, and Rotor says looking at a computer that the launch is a one-way transport. They hear a thud, Sonic comments on how fast that was, and they run up to above the base, leaving from a metal cylinder instead of a stump, to see what landed. Seriously though, they really should be leaving from a stump like in the old days. Wasn't that the point of bringing the old base back, to bring back the whole aesthetic and feel? It turns out that what made the thud was a bunch of talking AIs that combined themselves into Croctobot. It took several seconds for me to get this was actually Octobot fused with Croctobot in particular, because Octobot looks absolutely nothing like what he did the last time we saw him, completely failing as a callback as a result. I like that they brought back Croctobot though, since not only was he never properly used as a villain, but his remains escaped Sonic when a criminal got away with a biplane with him in it, so maybe those remains were sold to Eggman by criminals who wanted money, and Eggman gave them the money instead of roboticizing them. Or maybe he didn't, who knows. And the story ends with Scourge finally being in his famous design, renaming himself in a way that's more subtle and clever, rather than just outright saying, "I want to be called Scourge now." Instead he talks as if he's not all the same person anymore. Also he has shades now when he didn't the last time we saw him through. So what, did they magically poof up after he wasn't standing on the Master Emerald anymore? And it sure was nice of Scourge not to siphon literally all the Emerald's power, by the way. Although maybe he was planning to and the siphoning process was just going so slow that Locke interrupted it. But yeah, he has sunglasses again, and they're rose-tinted pink, which goes really well with this green fur color contrast-wise. Yet another indication he has great fashion sense. It's amusing to think about for him, or any Sonic really. I'd like to think that the reason he made them pink was also as an expression of his individuality, which he's been literally all about since he met Sonic. See, pink is a girl's color, so he chose pink sunglasses as a rebellion against that notion by society, saying, "Screw you guys, I can wear pink glasses if I want, because I'm awesome." I admire that attitude. I mean, I used to wear rose-tinted glasses a lot before I had to get real glasses, and now I can't exactly wear them over them. And I got chastised for wearing them for being a teenager and not a little girl. But Scourge is so proud and individualistic that he says, "Screw that rule, I'll wear what I want," which is cool. Anyways, in the next story, Blaze the Cat goes to Knothole because she wants to see the blue hedgehog she saw in her dream since she's psychic apparently and was able to dream a vision of someone she never met. She's surprised that he lives in such a little town. Was she expecting a luxury suite? Well, she was a princess, she probably is used to better, and we expect a hero to be more pampered by the people he saves. Although, I think that she would know what his village looks like, since how would she know to go to Knothole to find Sonic if she doesn't know what Knothole looks like? Why is she surprised that's such a little town? Anyways, does she know he's a hero? Apparently so, if only because her dream told her that Sonic will keep the Soul Emerald safe from Eggman. Then Blaze thinks what I was just thinking, complaining about how she'd have to seek out Sonic when the Soul Emeralds are her responsibility. But in spite of that, she wants to seek him out anyways, to protect them. This is certainly a departure from the game, that's for sure, and a good one. I don't blame the Swapbots for thinking she's a boy from the back of her head, because she has short hair after all. I can't help but be disappointed at just seeing regular Swapbots instead of the much cooler looking Shadow Swapbots that were Eggman's trademark. It made the comic more unique. Instead, let's just use normal Swapbots from now on, because SADAM used them, and that makes them the Holy Grail. Okay. The Swapbots decide to scan her because she's spying on Knothole, and realize they don't know her, and can't tell if she's a friend or foe. Why the hell don't they just assume everyone not on Eggman's side is a foe? They decide to use a stealth attack with a stun bolt to interrogate her later. The comic then insults my intelligence because it expects me to believe that after all this time of the Swapbots talking right behind her, She never turned around to look at them and attacked them. I fucking hate any time fiction does that. It's so dumb. And yet she was lucky enough to react in time to hearing the laser by jumping above it really high. I'm relieved. I thought she'd get knocked out immediately. Instead, she attacks them with karate kicks instead of fire, and then proceeds to immediately completely incinerate them. Wait, no, that's not what happens. Because bullshit, that's why. Instead, she gets major chickification, being knocked out from behind with a head blow when she should have completely incinerated them all with a fire tornado by now. Rotor tells Sonic that he sees surveillance footage of SWATbots carrying someone away, then asks him, "Do you think it's someone from the village?" As if that should be important to him. Sonic would save her regardless, wouldn't he? Rotor then says that the footage was taken almost an hour ago. Logically, Blaze should have been roboticized by then, judging by how worthless she's been shown to be this far. But I'm sure she'll be just fine. Sonic runs off optimistic because it's only been an hour, which I like, and then we see Blaze unconscious connected to a bunch of wires. A robot says, for the sake of exposition to the audience, that he was created along with other robots like him to research and monitor organics, but he's concerned that his scans might be malfunctioning because her physical data readings are bizarre, as if she's from another world. I'm guessing we'll never know how and in what ways they're bizarre. Why would they be bizarre when she looks just like a Mobian anyways? He shows that his devices can display her thoughts about the Soul Emeralds. Okay, so if Eggman has a literal mind-reading machine, then interrogation should be a snap for him from now on because he'll have the world's greatest lie detector. So I'm guessing this will be completely dropped and never referenced again. Then a robot says that because Blaze's readings also show impressive strength, they may be able to recruit her for Robotnik. He says that they shouldn't be too harsh with the interrogation because of this, probably because they don't want her to be too injured to be recruited. After Sonic shows up, Blaze wakes up just now because the plot demands it and starts talking weirdly about someone removing her mantle because she just woke up from a bad dream. And she seems to free herself by igniting her body in flames, which I assume don't hurt her from a protective force field just above her skin. I have a question. If she can do this kind of fire magic so easily, why the hell didn't she just do that to the SWATbots in the first place? We could have had her meet Sonic without pulling a Princess Peach and getting kidnapped. She was on his way to meet him anyways. This issue was pretty fun to read, even if I had a lot to say about it because you could nitpick it to death. The first story was the first ever one written by Ian Flynn, who was actually a Sonic fan. And as I expected, it was an excellent first impression, although I'm really confused by them acting as if the Freedom Fighters base from the old issues had been destroyed when I don't remember that happening at all. So while I'm happy it's back, I'm also pretty confused that it left off screen. And Sonic was way too carefree about Shadow working for Eggman for seemingly no reason. That was just ridiculous. But in general, this was a story where Fiona got my absolute sympathy by heart-wrenchingly being glared at and made to feel like an outcast by a very judgmental Sally because she used to work with Bean and Bark. She doesn't even try to explain why she worked with them and why she had a checkered past. I mean, it should be obvious. She was an orphan who did what she could to get food and water, including steel. Not to mention she used to work with Nicolette, a bounty hunter. So it's not like she suddenly has this checkered past. Why the hell are they surprised by her being a former criminal when they should know she used to work with Nicolette? Did Mighty and Ray keep that a secret? It should be obvious that she was just doing what she could to survive, and yet she doesn't even try to defend what she did. I guess she had no hope whatsoever for being accepted. At the very least, Sonic and Tails were welcoming to her. Sonic was very welcoming, remember that. And Tails and Elias had to be held back from approaching Sally angrily during a little moment. Although that doesn't justify them not saying a word in her defense. And Tails gave her a drink when she was feeling like an outcast moping around, causing her to ruffle his hair having a friendship moment with him for literally the first time. They really didn't give a shit with this character, this is the first time she's done this. She was also useful for literally the second time by getting rid of Bean using shiny keys, which is necessary since he was on Sonic's head and he couldn't shake him off. It's just a shame Sally had such a cruel way of thanking her. And just the fact that she got all suspicious of her instead of just assuming Bean and Bark were Fiona's old enemies. Just that fact alone is kind of a diabolus ex machina, arbitrarily making it more annoying for her. Sally's paranoid at times, sure, but still. Nothing else to say about the story other than that there was lots of charming dialogue and I love that Scourge got the way he did. And the second story was written in pencil by Tanya Del Rio, who thank God has changed her art style since the Nicole story to not be alienating this time. And honestly, the story, I ended up hating it because of what it did to Blaze. She would not get knocked out by SWATbots that easily. She would have incinerated all of them in the time it took for that to happen. And they say Sally got chickification. They try to make up for it by having her look super powerful at the end, but by then it's too late. And I'm just wondering why she didn't do all this earlier. What a humiliating first impression. She didn't need to be captured by Eggman like a helpless princess just for Sonic to meet her.